Beware of the blob, it creeps and leaps and glides and slides across the floor, right through the door and all around the wall. A splotch, a blotch, be careful of the blob.
In the rainforest can grow to be about that big. It's just huge.
Black-footed spiders. The female is much more poisonous than the male, and the female is about twice as large too. And when they, after they mate, the male will eat, or the female will eat the male. And this spider here, it's not a black widow, it's a black and yellow garden spider that you may find in your garden. And the kids that are coming in, they have to answer the question, do the spiders have more venom than the rattlesnakes? And yes, they do. Female black widow spider is more venom. Although her bites aren't poisonous most of the time.
Beware of the blob, it creeps and leaps and glides and slides across the floor, right through the door and all around the wall. A splotch, a blotch, be careful of the blob.
And they have long necks, so I have to be very careful because he does snap at you. Did you get a good shot of them?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
We have the smaller snapping turtle. He hasn't learned to snap yet. Don't get a good shot of that guy. He's an African frog.
Beware of the blob, it creeps.
Here the boys and girls are getting ready to do a hunt for animals like worms and snakes and wasps and flies and black widow spiders. And they're making their box first, and then they'll get the directions for going on the hunt. And along the way on the hunt, they'll get to pick up a snake and a fly and a bee and a bat.
You need to take this
So maybe what you need to do is go around and see some of those different areas where they're doing that. There's the bat over there.
We'll be right back. of the blob, it creeps and leaps and glides and slides across the floor, right through the door, and all around the wall, a splotch, a blotch, be careful of the blob.
We're helping people assemble them, and these are the wings, and this is the body, and this is the head, and then we put the eyes on the head. Everybody seems to be enjoying it.
Thank you.
Beware of the blob, it creeps and leaps and glides and slides across the floor, right through the door and all around the wall. A splotch, a blotch, be careful of the blob.
Call to its mate, which is over there somewhere. This thing jumps.
That's the noise it makes during our class.
All during our class.
Did you hear that?
For 50 minutes.
Yeah, me.
Beware of the blob, it creeps and leaps and glides and slides across the floor, right through the door and all around the wall. A splotch, a blotch, be careful of the blob.
I'm gonna bring this, if you can't get this slime, bring the slime to you. Grab it, take a handful. Icky.
Beware of the blob, it creeps and leaps and glides and slides across the floor, right through the door and all around the wall. A splotch, a blotch, be careful of the blob. Beware of the blob, it creeps and leaps and glides and slides.
And this is Lois Sokolsky, and she's going to be talking to you about the bats and some of the things that she does with them.
Okay. Hi. My name's Lois Sikorsky, I'll repeat it, but if you remember Lois, that's enough. And if you should ever have a wild animal problem, there is a newsletter over by the bat posters and everything that your parents can have, and it has our phone number on so that you can find me. What I do all day long is take care of wildlife, wild animals, bats, squirrels, chipmunks, whatever there happens to be that's orphaned. In other words, something happened to their moms, or they're injured. A lot of animals get injured on our highways, and so they don't have anybody to take them to the veterinarian. Like if you have a dog or a cat, and your dog or cat gets sick, don't you take them to the vet? Okay, now wild animals don't have that, and so I'm the person who, when your mom or dad or you find a wild animal that's hurt or a baby that's orphaned, I'm the person in Allegheny County that takes care of them. There's two of us. The other person's at the Pittsburgh Zoo or near the Pittsburgh Zoo. So I'm out here in your area, so I'm probably the person your animals will see. Bats are wonderful wild animals, but I have to tell you one thing about wild animals that you have to understand. Even though you see me touch these bats today, I don't want you to ever touch wildlife. Okay? Don't touch squirrels, don't touch bats, never. If you find any wild animal that is on the ground or coming up to you to eat from your hand, never give him a chance to bite. It is very, very important to me because they'll have to put that animal to sleep to test him and see if he has disease. Okay? So even though you see my hands on the bats, I don't want you to ever do that, all right? Everybody promise, because I would never want you to leave here and think you can touch wildlife. Never, ever, never, ever, ever, ever. Okay, bats are wonderful because there's almost 1,000 different kinds of them. And I know if you look at the bats outside or you look in any of the bat books, you're going to get a list of bat books you can look at. But if you look at, there's 900 to 1,000 different kinds of bats. They have funny noses. They have big ears. They have the greatest teeth. Can you imagine something that ate insects? Why, they have to have great big teeth to grab them in the air. And so they have these big ugly teeth. And everything about these animals is designed to allow them to do well. All bats are mammals. What's a mammal? Give me an idea.
It's warm-blooded.
It's warm-blooded. Tell me anything else.
It has a backbone.
Sure. Keep going.
Don't lay.
Doesn't lay eggs?
It has fur.
It has fur. Yeah, give me, you have some pet mammals probably. What are your pet mammals? Give me some. Gentleman there.
I have
mouse. Mouse is a good one. Lady.
Cat.
Sure, cat.
Dog.
Right. Now, everybody wants to say bats are great, they're flying mice. Well, that's one heck of a thing to make people like them. Think of them as maybe flying puppies and kittens. I mean, you know, they're cute little guys. So I want you to think that they're mammals, they're warm-blooded, they take wonderful care of their young. I'm sure everybody's read old Stella.
Oh, Stella.
There's old Stella. Stella, they take very good care. If Stella had young, because she was a young bat in the book, I remember. If Stella had young, they nurse their young, they feed them milk, they cover them with their wings to take care of them. They're very, very kind to their young. And when we raise young bats, we have to be extremely kind to them also. The one thing that they do, however, that's different, all right, than most other mammals is they have the ability to fly. They can fly better than birds. In these programs that I do, I always follow some dumb guy with a bunch of birds with him. And he's always telling people how wonderful birds are. Nothing flies like a bat. Nothing in the world flies like the bats do because they use what we think is wonderful on us to fly. What do they fly with?
Wings,
but there's something special about those wings. They don't have feathers on their wings. What do they have? Does anybody know? I think I've called on you guys before. Go ahead.
Fingers.
Yeah, they are hand-winged flyers. Let me tell you what this means. Now, don't anybody hit anybody, but everybody stand up. Come on, stand up. You too. You're not getting out of this. Okay. Now, I want you to use your imagination with this because you get the idea of how bats fly. Put your hands out at the side and nobody punch anybody doing this. If somebody's in front of you, sort of give yourself a little room. And put your thumbs up, okay? because they do have regular thumbs and regular hands. Now you have to do this with me. You have to put your fingers now facing downward. Put your fingers down, okay? Now use your imagination, and I want you to imagine on your own hand that each one of your fingers is growing longer and longer. Not your whole hand, just each one of your fingers is getting longer and longer until it touches the ground. Okay, now look at your hands. Look at those long, thin bones. Okay, they're touching the ground now. Now, there is a webbing between each of those long bones. If I were a bat, in other words, there would be a web between them. Now, what I want you to do is think about what would happen if you made those hands move. Think of how big your wings would be. You would have huge wings, 20-foot wings. They would be horrendous. And you would be able to fly very, very well. This and every single one, see these things in your wings? Look at your hand again. Each little part of your finger, even though they're long down to the ground, is able to move. And so when a bat flies like that, okay? If you think about your bats flying like that, each time they move, they're able to adjust their flight. Okay, sit down. Bats don't fly into windows, walls, whatever. Okay, they are not able, they don't do that. Birds, I don't know how many birds I get. People come to me with a bird and says, look, this bird has hit my window. That's probably one of the most common things that I see because birds don't have the ability to back up. I'm not allowed to let my bats go, but if they were able to run to fly around this room, they would fly up to that wall and stop, turn around and fly back. They have no problem with adjusting their flight. And we think we're great people, and we're tremendously smart because we have hands with thumbs. And they have the same thing, only they've developed the ability to fly with them. They're really great. Now, there's only one problem that the bats do have, and that is, what do they eat in Pennsylvania? The only thing that they eat in Pennsylvania, young woman in the back. They do eat some worms, but they eat worms that are only parts of something else. What do bats eat in Pennsylvania? Because I feed mine mealworms. That's why you're partially right.
Bugs.
They eat insects, right. They eat bugs and beetles and any kind of mosquitoes, anything like that. We have no vampires in Pennsylvania. So unless you're a chicken or a cow in Costa Rica, you don't have to worry about vampire bats. And even there, chickens and cows don't worry about them because they just make a little tiny hole and lick the blood off of the top. So vampires are no big deal, all right? The things that you see in movies and the stories that made your parents and grandparents afraid, based on that big Bram Stoker novel, Dracula, you know, that type of thing, that is just a lot of history and tales put together. It has nothing to do with reality. Okay, they have a problem with insects. When do they find their insects? What time of day? Nighttime. All right, let me give you another thing to imagine. Suppose I said to you, imagine this, I have a box of cockroaches, beetles, moths, I have 100,000 bugs in here. And in a few minutes, we're gonna turn off the light and I'm gonna toss the bugs all over the room. Aren't you gonna love that? Well, I'm not gonna love that too much either. Not that I'm afraid of them, but it would be a really wiggly mess. Now, suppose you were a bat and we turned out the lights and you had to find them for your food. What do bats do to find their food in the dark? Gentlemen in the second row.
They find them with radar.
Sort of. That's exactly right, but I want to get another name. Young woman under the tripod.
Echolocation.
Echolocation, yeah. Another big word that you should know. They are able to locate, wait, let me do it back, right side. They are able to locate their food, okay, by sending out a sound and causing an echo. Now, let me borrow Stella again for a second and take my insect out of the box. Imagination again. This is my insect. Stella sends out a sound. Ping. Okay, now here's Stella flying along, ping, ping, and all of a sudden up comes the insect. So here's Stella, ping, and it That ping sound hits the insect and comes back to Stella's ears, and of course she's quite happy. But when it comes back to Stella's ears, that doesn't say ping to Stella. That says insect. And it, the sound that has left Stella's mouth is changed by the insect. And when it comes back to her ears, she says, ah, dinner. And so she goes, ping, ping. And here's insect, insect. And she goes, ping, ping, ping. And here's bug, bug, bug. And she goes faster and faster. And finally, she grabs it and eats the insect. OK? Let me show you on my own bats what this is like. This ping, first of all, if we have 1,000 insects around here, 1,000 insects, if we have 1,000 bats around here, and they're all out at night. There's a lot of bats out at night. I don't know if you see them or not. If you go out when the sky is very blue in the summertime, just at dusk, in other words, you know how right when the sun goes down, the sky gets really bright blue? That's the time to look for insects. Okay. When they go out at that time, you can't hear them. Why not? The gentleman in the black tie. Oh, you, pardon me? Oh, okay. Can I get somebody else who hasn't answered? Why can't you hear the echolocation stuff? Does anybody else know? Gentleman in the back.
Because you know, they have special type of hearing.
Okay, they have special type of hearing, and the sound itself coming from the bat is above our hearing, okay? It's like what your dog can hear. Whenever I lose a bat in the house, I always get my dog to look for them. This is one of my bats that I have. And if you, when all the programs are over, if you want to come back in, I have three common bats in here of Pennsylvania. But I want to show you her because this is a big brown bat.
See her?
No, this is called a big brown bat. She eats only insects. And she was an orphan and has lived with me for about a year. I call her baby bat, because she's our youngest bat. But isn't she wonderful? Now I'm going to see if I can let you, if you, as long as she's cooperative this morning, maybe she'll let you hear her echolocate, okay? Let me turn this around. Yeah, you're going to echolocate for me, sweetie? On. If I drop her down, she'll echolocate. What you will hear is the ping. Of course, she fell. Let me pick her up again so you can hear it again. She's making all that noise. See? Now, what she's doing is judging how far she is from the ground. That's why you're hearing the pings. Hear the pings? Can you hear the pings? She's judging where she is. And she's making lots of pings. Now, remember what I told you. When she was flying up in the air, and she'd go ping. But when she wants detail, when she wants to know exactly where she is and what she's doing, then she gives lots of pings. Let me see if I can get her to just do a few pings for you. She is searching now. See, she's not enclosed. And so she's searching for what she wants to do. Hear it? She is sending out sound. If you could see her very closely, I don't think you can see her closely enough. And I can't let go of her, believe me. Let me put her back down again, and you'll hear her do it a lot, because you know what to listen for. Now, see, she wants to see how close she is to the ground, so she'll do a lot. Wait, get off my hand, and then you'll see whether you're coming down. Come on. She knows me too well. Can you, it's real low. Can you hear it now?
Yeah.
Okay. She's sending out really tiny little ping. Oh. Now she's got it going. Okay, that's echolocation. And you can't hear that, but the bats are, thousands of them are doing that every night as they fly around here and trying to find their food. Where are the bats going now? You're not going to see bats easily now. That's right. Most of our bats here in western Pennsylvania. Right. They do something called hibernation. And most people don't understand it. Hibernation is very important in Pennsylvania because we devote a whole day to some other darn animal that's not as great as bats. And what's that? Groundhog. Yeah, Groundhog's Day. Bats also are hibernators just like the groundhog, but they don't get credit for it. And they don't wake up and tell us whether it's spring or not. They go into a cave where a cave is between 40 and 50 degrees, right at the front, okay, of the cave. And some caves in Pennsylvania are 55, but most of them are in the 40s. And they sleep a special sleep, which we can't do because we'd be dead if we did it, at about 40, 45 degrees. And this allows them to not eat all winter and sleep all winter. Why do you think they developed this? Why do you think they have to hibernate? What did I tell you they did? That means that they have to do something special. Like, there's only two things that animals like this do in the winter. One is hibernate and the other is migrate. Birds, a lot of birds migrate. All the birds that migrate and bats do it for what reason? Nope. Somebody else. Sort of. They'll die, but for not just die from the cold. Nope. They do the same thing if it gets too hot.
No food.
There's no insects out for them to catch at night. So they have to either migrate like birds or they have to hibernate, and this is why they do this. They're wonderful. I want to ask you one thing very, very importantly right now. I'm going to give you a few minutes for questions if we have it. I don't know. But I see an awful lot of animals that are orphaned or injured, guys. And I want to ask you very, very carefully to share the earth with wildlife.
Beware of the blob. It creeps and leaps and glides and slides across the floor, right through the door and all around the wall. A splotch, a blotch. Be careful of